You're listening to the audio production of The Age of AI, Artificial Intelligence and the Future of Humanity by Jason Thacker, published by Zondervan and read by Jakob Lewis. Foreword read by John Behrens. Foreword. When I was doing my doctoral studies in philosophy, I participated in a seminar in which we talked a lot about minds and machines. We dealt with questions about whether computers could ever really think in the way humans do, and whether they could replicate our form of consciousness. We considered a lot of examples, but they were mainly hypothetical. A favorite was the Turing test. Jason Thacker has a nice discussion of it in this book, where we had to speculate about what it would take for a computer to fool us into thinking that we were communicating with another person. Again, these were all pretty much hypothetical cases. At the time, this was in the late 1960s, we had few examples to go on, so we did a lot of speculation. There were, of course, some chess-playing computers at the time, but there was quite a bit of skepticism about whether they were really playing the game, as opposed to simply going through possible moves that they had been programmed to process. These days, we are dealing with more than hypotheticals. I frequently ask Siri to send my wife a text about when I will arrive home from a meeting, and when Siri tells me that the text has been sent, I sometimes find myself saying, "Thank you." That may not be a successful outcome of a Turing test, but I do wonder on occasion about the philosophical and theological implications of my impulsive response. In this marvelous book, Jason Thacker gives us much help in thinking through those implications. For Christians, the questions get at the heart of things. Discussions of artificial intelligence typically focus on the degree to which new technological devices are starting to be like us. Will they replace us in some significant way? Will they even surpass us in their ability to accomplish things that we always thought were unique to human efforts? Jason Thacker is aware of the profound character of these concerns for Christians. The Bible begins with a clear portrayal of the us, human beings, male and female, created in the very image and likeness of the living God. But we learn also that our first parents soon decided to be their own gods, thus getting all of us into a horrible mess. Our sinful condition means that we have a difficult time finding the rightful place of the us in the overall scheme of things. Sometimes we define humanity down, reducing ourselves to the level of animals. And sometimes we define ourselves up, as in the recent transhumanist patterns of thought that are nicely explained in this book. What we Christians cannot settle for is a simple rejection of technological advances. The Lord can use artificial intelligence for good things, which means that we must think seriously, grounded in fidelity to the Scriptures, about important theological questions. This book is an excellent guide for doing just that. And as Jason Thacker makes abundantly clear, the issues are not abstract concerns. He provides splendid insights into what they mean for raising our children, faithful engagement in our daily work, communicating the gospel, and much more. I am deeply grateful for what I have learned in reading this book about matters that are of crucial importance for the life of the Christian community. Richard J. Mouw.
Chapter 1. Foundation, Man and Machine. When I mention artificial intelligence, the first thing that comes to people's minds is likely to be science fiction stories, such as the movie iRobot. You know, robots plotting to enslave humanity, or perhaps a humanoid robot learning to demonstrate and feel human emotions and eager to integrate into the human world, as Andrew did in Bicentennial Man. Artificial intelligence seems far off and futuristic to us. As a result, we haven't given much thought to it and aren't sure that we will need to anytime soon. For all of the sci-fi movies and TV shows that flood our screens year after year, we might have missed that we have already welcomed various forms of artificial intelligence into our families and homes. Artificial intelligence, AI, is a crucial piece of many forms of technology today, including smartphones, social media, search platforms, and smart home devices. Famed computer scientist and futurist Ray Kurzweil says that if all of the AI systems decided to go on strike tomorrow, our civilization would be crippled. We couldn't get money from our bank, and indeed, our money would disappear. Communication, transportation, and manufacturing would all grind to a halt. AI is everywhere, even if you don't recognize it. But for all of its advantages and benefits, AI is also challenging some of the basic principles of life, causing many to wonder about human nature and what really makes us distinct from the rest of creation. AI is doing things like driving cars around our streets and automating countless jobs that were created for humans. AI is changing everything about our world and society, and we aren't prepared. Artificial intelligence is the technology of today and tomorrow. So where do we begin our journey to understand it? We must begin where everything began, in the pages of Scripture. Scripture is our guide to navigating this world with wisdom and ultimately points us to Jesus Christ, the founder and perfecter of our faith. Hebrews 12:2. Seeking wisdom. Scripture never mentions anything about artificial intelligence. That likely isn't a surprise to you. Many of the issues we face in life are not explicitly addressed in the Bible. But God's Word supplies wisdom to us as we encounter tough questions. So I propose two questions to aid us in our journey to apply God's Word to artificial intelligence. 1. What does it mean to be human? 2. What is technology and artificial intelligence? What does it mean to be human? The book of Genesis describes how God created everything in our world. He created the heavens and the earth. He created everything that has ever been known. Before the creation of space and time, only God existed, in the eternal Trinity as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Colossians 1, 13-17. Not only did God create the heavens and the earth, but He created everything on our planet. He created the waters of the sea and the grass of the land. He created the birds of the air and the teeming life of the seemingly bottomless oceans. Not only did God choose to create the heavens and the earth, the waters and the land, the birds of the air and the fish of the sea, but He chose to create humanity. And He did so for a purpose. The image of God. Humanity is distinct from everything in God's creation. There is something unique about us compared with everything else that God made. Genesis 1:26 says, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness." God chose to make us in His image. He crafted us to be like Him. After God created man, He said that He was very good, as opposed to just good, like He had said on the previous 5 days. But what was so unique about humanity? God gave us specific jobs and responsibilities to perform as we seek to reflect Him in this world. "And God blessed them, and God said to them, 'Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the heavens, and over every living thing that moves on the earth.'" 1:28. Our job is to be fruitful and multiply, to fill the earth and subdue it, and to take dominion over all of creation. This means raising families, working the ground, and caring for creation. To work the ground is another way of saying to do our jobs by using the abilities God has given us. That means being the best plumber, designer, student, leader, or parent that you can be to the glory of God. God has given each of His image bearers gifts to use as they seek the good of society. These jobs are not a result of sin or a punishment for our rebellion. They were given to us so that we might reflect Him in the world. God gave us minds and bodies to do the jobs He created us to do. Our minds and bodies allow us to reflect God as we work. For example, we can be creative and design things unlike anything else in creation. As part of our creativity, we make technology to aid us in our God-given responsibilities. Genesis 2:15 tells us that God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and keep it. What God calls us to do, He provides for us to do. He gives us the tools to fulfill our callings. One gift that God has given us is our minds. Having minds means that we are able to use reason to process, plan, and execute what God has given us the responsibility to do. With our minds, we are able to design and create in ways that nothing else in creation is able to do. Even the smartest of animals, such as the beaver, which constructs a massive structure made of precisely laid sticks, or the lesser-known cathedral termite, which builds homes 15 feet tall that function as self-sustaining megacities, cannot compare with the abilities of humans. We are able to use our minds to create technology and even forms of artificial intelligence that can mimic how we, as humans, think and plan. There is no other part of creation that has been given the minds and talents that God has bestowed on us as His image bearers. As you and I reflect God with our creative abilities, we are able to make things that allow us to live our callings as workers in easier and more efficient ways that benefit all of society. Think about all of the tools that we use each day that make our lives easier, from hammers and nails to digital devices like smartphones and computers. We design and create tools that allow us to work in a broken world that is not the way God designed it to be. The Rebellion. Genesis 3 describes when things fell apart. Adam and Eve were tempted to believe a lie about God, and they decided to rebel against Him. Their rebellion is our rebellion, 1 Corinthians 15:22. This rebellion brought sin into the world and broke the natural order of things. Our lives and work are more difficult than they were designed to be. Things don't work as they should. Sin brought sickness, death, brokenness, and shame into our world. But for all of the effects of sin in our lives and our world, the image of God in us was not lost. We are still able to create, design, and make things, but it is a much harder process in our fallen world. Work comes with pitfalls, unintended consequences, technological failures, and things that don't operate the way they are designed to. Also, the purpose behind technology is skewed in our minds. We misuse and abuse the gifts that God has given us and contort them for sinful and prideful means. We use technology to hurt others, to distract and distance ourselves from God, and to make ourselves feel more important than we are. Given how we were created and the work that we are called to do, what is the proper purpose and use of technology amid this brokenness? What is technology? Technology is a tool that helps us live out our God-given callings. This is one of the most important things for us to learn as we engage the topic of technology and artificial intelligence. Because we often see the tremendous power that technology has over our lives, we are tempted to treat technology as more than a tool, as something with a value similar to our own if it is powerful enough or does enough work on its own. Technology will be misused and abused by broken people just like you and me. Nowhere in Scripture is a tool or a technology condemned for being evil. Scripture shows that technology and tools can be used for both good and evil. Even if a tool was designed for evil, the tool itself isn't evil. What is sinful isn't the sword, but how people choose to use it. It can be used for righteous purposes like standing up for justice against those who are evil. But it can also be used to hurt or kill the innocent. While the technology isn't moral in that sense, it does carry with it the effects of sin and brokenness. Technology is not morally neutral because it influences and changes us each time we use it. Technology expands what is possible for humans to do. It can be best thought of as a catalyst or an accelerant for change because it opens new opportunities for humans to live in this world. Broken, sinful, and evil humans are the ones given the abilities to create these tools and the ones who can choose how we use them. Paul reminds us that each of us has fallen short and needs to repent, Romans 3:23. The world itself did not sin. Our tools did not rebel. We did. The story of Cain and Abel is a great example of this truth about the purpose and use of technology. Both Cain and Abel were created by God with specific skills and talents. Both used tools, early forms of technology, to work the ground and care for animals. But Cain sinned and chose to use his God-given strength and abilities to kill a fellow image-bearer. He chose to take the good gifts that God gave him and use them for evil and selfish purposes. Technology is not new. In our digital world, it is easy for us to believe that technology always takes the form of digital and computer technology, limiting our idea of technology to our smartphones and computers. But even crude tools used to cultivate the ground and construct things are forms of technology. Shovels, hoes, hammers, nails, and saws are all technological innovations. These tools were revolutionary pieces of technology. They changed everything about our lives, from the foods we ate to the places we lived. One of the most important pieces of technology in all of human history is the printing press. Johannes Gutenberg is credited with inventing the world's first movable type printing press in 1450, and it revolutionized the world. It allowed books and other materials to be mass-produced cheaply and efficiently, and made them available for mass distribution, not just for the wealthy.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.